Esther is not mentioned anywhere else in the scriptures. The book, the tale, and yet it is one of the most beloved stories of the Jewish nation. They celebrate it to this day with a holiday that they call Purim. And Purim, we're going to find out what that means tonight in the story of Esther. God, we noted last week, is not mentioned in the book of Esther either. Not by specifically by name, although he's very evident all through the book. There is nobody else that could be doing the things that are happening in the book of Esther except that there is a God in heaven who is watching out for and protecting his people. Amen? So the book of Esther is a parenthesis between Ezra chapter 6 and Ezra chapter 7. If you'd been reading through the history of Israel in the Old Testament there, you'd find after the times of the kings, Babylon conquered, obviously, Judah and led them into captivity. Later on, Babylon was conquered in turn by Persia. And Cyrus, the Persian king that captured Babylon, he let some of the Jews return. For the specific purpose of rebuilding the temple. After Cyrus, King Darius arose, and he's mentioned in the scriptures as well. And then after him was King Xerxes, or Ahasuerus, as he's known in Hebrew. And so those three, four, these three kings we're dealing with in this part of the history. So where we are now in history is they did go back into the land according to the decree of Cyrus, and they did finally rebuild the temple through a lot of trials and tribulations and the encouragement of the prophets. They finally completed the temple. Later, Nehemiah would return and rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, which had also been destroyed and torn down. And so that's where we are, between the temple being finished and Nehemiah returning to rebuild the wall. Right in there, there's a parenthesis, this other book. Meanwhile, back in Persia, this was happening with the Jews that didn't return, because a lot of them, of course, stayed in Persia. We know what year it is from the king that's mentioned. That's Xerxes. Because we know a lot about King Xerxes. At the beginning of the book, it's 483 BC. That is the third year of the reign of Ahasuerus, as he's called in the scripture, or Xerxes as we know him from history. If you're in the book of Esther, turn to chapter 3. That's where we're going to be picking it up in just a minute. Then some things happen. Different things go on. The king gets rid of his queen because she angers him. They have a beauty contest, and Esther is put forward, and she becomes the queen, and he falls in love with her. And now it's the seventh year of his reign, so now it's 479 BC. And King Ahasuerus, now at this point in the story, is in his palace. And wicked Haman, now when you read the story, whenever we mention Haman, everybody has to say, boo, right? Wicked Haman, boo. Very good, boo, he's a bad guy. He's his number one man in the palace. Mordecai, the Jew, is outside the gate, and Queen Esther is inside the palace. Now, we mentioned last week there's an allegory here. These people represent certain aspects in our lives. The king, King Ahasuerus, is the soul of a person. He determines what happens with the body. Whatever you determine in your soul, your mind, will, and emotions, that's what your body does. So all 127 provinces carry out the desire and the edict of the king, or the soul of that person. Haman, little delay, but that's good. You're catching on quick. He represents the flesh. He represents the flesh. He is our enemy in the things of Christ. The flesh is our enemy in the things of Christ. As Galatians chapter 5 says, for the flesh sets its desire against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. And then further on it says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. That means they give it no place and no power in their lives. Paul said, I beat my body and I make it my slave. Some of your versions read, I buffet my body, and you misread that as I buffet my body. That's not what it says. I beat my body and make it my slave, lest I be disqualified at the end because of my desires and passions pulling me in the wrong direction. How many know that the desires of the flesh are trouble? Yeah, most of us know that. Yet, Ephesians chapter 5 tells us no one ever hated his own flesh or his own body. You've got to live with it. You've got to live inside it. And some of the things that your flesh tell you are necessary. It's good to know when you're hungry, right? But to be always hungry, that's not good, right? That could be another little trick of the flesh there. So we have to live with it, but the flesh is the enemy of the spirit. And Haman was the enemy of the Jews. And In chapter 8... he's described as the enemy of the Jews. In chapter 9, it says Haman, the Jews' enemy. And in chapter 7, a foe and an enemy is this wicked Haman. Boo, boo, boo. So at the beginning of the story, Haman has utmost control and influence over the king, because he has been put into the palace as the king's right-hand man. In fact, he's been put in charge of all 127 provinces of the entire kingdom of Persia. Now, Queen Esther represents the spirit, not the Holy Spirit, but our human spirit. That portion of us that is reborn when we're born again, that portion to which God's spirit speaks. It can be regenerated and reborn and indwelled by the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 8 says, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. So that is the part of you that receives the truth of God. That is the antenna in you that hears the word of God when he speaks to your heart. So Queen Esther is God's ally inside the court to direct the king towards righteousness. Mordecai, he represents Christ. And although he saved the king, he saved his life. We found that last time he uncovered a plot to assassinate the king, and he brought it to light. The king was saved. Although he has saved him, yet he's outside the gates. He's got nothing to do with what's going on inside at the beginning of the story. And as we noted last time, the whole point of this book is to get the wrong man out and the right man in. That's what we need. We need the right man, Jesus Christ, on the throne in the palace. So, to recap, Babylon sacks Jerusalem, take the Jews captive. Cyrus the Persian conquers Babylon, and some of the Jews come back, they return. Xerxes, queen, wins the battle but loses the war. She's out, so they have a beauty contest. It lasts 4 years. Aha, this is great. Esther's included. She wins. Xerxes goes off and beats Leonidas the Spartan at Thermopylae, and he burns Athens. Then the Athenians destroy the Persian fleet. Yay! And then another Spartan general defeats their army. But Xerxes is on his way back to Persia by that point, back to Susa. That has nothing to do with our stories, but guys really like that stuff. As well as a lot of actors with six packs. So Xerxes returns defeated. He has just put forward the greatest fighting army that the world has seen to that time. Almost 2 million soldiers, 4,000 ships. all gone, all lost. It's a bad year for him. And he comes back. But hey, Esther wins his heart. So he returns sad, but now he's happy. He takes her as his queen. He makes her queen over the whole kingdom. And then Mordecai exposes a plot against the king. So now we come to Esther chapter 3, and we want to get moving because the story is about to start with all these characters that we've put on the stage now. After these events, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of Hammedatha the Agagite, and advanced him and established his authority over all the princes who were with him. All the king's servants who were at the king's gate bowed down and paid homage to Haman, for so the king had commanded concerning him. But Mordecai neither bowed down nor paid homage. Then the king's servants who were at the king's gate said to Mordecai, "Why are you transgressing the king's command?" Now, we had also noted last week how dangerous Xerxes could be. He could turn on a friend in an instant, fly into a rage, and do almost anything. You just didn't cross this guy. And yet, here is Mordecai not doing what the king has said. Everybody bows down to that guy, but not Mordecai because, well, he's the enemy of the Jews. Verse 4. Now it was when they had spoken daily to him, and he would not listen to them, that they told Haman, to see whether Mordecai's reason would stand, for he had told them that he was a Jew. God himself had said, the Amalekites are perpetual enemies of Israel. Verse 5. When Haman, saw that Mordecai neither bowed down nor paid homage to him, Haman was filled with rage. We should have things to twirl or something like that. He was filled with rage. Now, that's the flesh, requiring everybody to bow down and give honor to the flesh. We all know that. That can rise up in any of us, right? That is the flesh to the max. But he decided he's going to get even with this guy who's taxing him. But just getting rid of Mordecai is not enough. He's going to get rid of all of Mordecai's people. He's going to annihilate all of the Jews. He would wipe them out. So they decided, well, when would be the most opportune time to do this? So they cast lots. Lots are called pur. And that's where the term Purim comes from, the casting of lots. So they do this for an entire year to determine which one comes up most propitious for the date that they will carry out their plot. So they cast lots every day for a whole year, from March to February. And boy, I tell you, the flesh can really hold a grudge, right? I mean, good grief, this is going on for 12 months and the guy is still livid with rage, you know, about the whole thing. Verse 8, then Haman said to King Ahasuerus, "There is a certain people scattered and dispersed among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from those of all other people, and they do not observe the king's laws. So it is not in the king's interest to let them remain. If it is pleasing to the king, let it be decreed that they be destroyed. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who carry on the king's business to put into the king's treasuries." Okay, so long story short, he says, "Oh, that's a good idea. They should be getting rid of if they don't follow my laws and my commands." Verse 13, letters were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces to destroy, to kill, and to annihilate all the Jews, both young and old, women and children, in one day, the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month Adar, and seize their possessions as plunder. Oh, that's a sad time for the Jews, right? Here you are anywhere in the Persian Empire, all the way across the Middle East, into the Holy Land, everywhere they've stretched. If you're them, people can kill you and take your stuff on this day with the king's blessing, which is a guy you don't cross. So this is terrible. So all of these letters are going out now. It takes another year for the decree to get out there. So now it's been 2 years, 1 year figuring out what the right day was going to be, and another year actually putting the plan in motion to get there. So verse 15, the couriers went out, hastened by the king's command, while the decree was issued at the citadel in Susa. And while the king and Haman, sat down to drink, the city of Susa was in what? Confusion. Oh. Keep your place here, but turn to Romans chapter 7, if you would. Romans chapter 7 in the New Testament. It says the whole city was in confusion. So Haman, is the flesh, and the Jews are representing the plans and purposes of God. When allowed, the flesh not only wars against God's way, but brings in confusion to the person's life, right? How many of you found that to be true? You give in to the flesh, you start living according to the flesh as a Christian, and it's confusion. It's just confusing to you, everybody around you, your whole family, and it just goes from bad to worse. Like we have here in Romans chapter 7, verse 14. Why is this? It says, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of flesh, sold into bondage to sin. For what I am doing, I did not understand, but I am not practicing what I would like to do, but I am doing the very thing that I hate. You see the confusion there? That's how the flesh brings in confusion into your life, if it's allowed to have that place. I don't understand. I'm not doing what I want to do. Confusion. Now, note what it says about the law. He says the law is spiritual. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means that the law is more than I have understood at times. Because I always figured the law was just rules and regulations, concrete, do this, don't do that. You have to do it this way. But it apparently is more than that. It's not just outward. The law is spiritual. It's speaking something spiritual to me if I can hear what the law has to say. And what is that? Well, Paul says the law is our tutor to point us to Christ. The law is there to make us understand we need a Savior and to point us to Him when that time comes. So, the legalist, of course, uses it simply as outward, but Paul says, no, it's spiritual. It's spiritual as well. And it has a spiritual purpose. So when the flesh gets its way, there's confusion. But thankfully, Paul concludes that Christ sets the Christian free from the tyranny of the flesh. Praise the Lord for that. And there's no more condemnation for the Christian as he's accepted Christ. Okay, so let's go back to Esther again. You kept your place, right? Chapter 4. Let's get into chapter 4. When Mordecai learned that all that had been done, he tore his clothes. He put on sackcloth and ashes and went out into the midst of the city and wailed loudly and bitterly. He went as far as the king's gate, for no one was to enter the king's gate clothed in sackcloth. So, Mordecai and Esther start texting to each other. Mordecai, OMG, go plead with the king. Esther, LOL, no one goes uninvited. Thought we were BFF, but no call in 30 days? Question mark. Mordecai, verse 13. Then Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, do not imagine that you in the king's palace can escape any more than all the Jews. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place, and you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not attained royalty for such a time as this? Esther texts back, verse 16. Go, assemble all the Jews who are found in Susa, and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, day or night, or night or day. And I and my maidens will also fast in the same way. Thus I will go into the king, which is not according to the law, and if I perish, I perish. Wow. Kind of reminds me of Romans chapter 14, where Paul writes, well, if we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we're whose? We're the Lord's. We're property of His. He owns us. Whether He decides we are to live or whether we are to die, we are the Lord. So this is what she says. I will go in, which is not according to the law. You don't come in unless you're summoned by the king. And as we know, he can be in a mood. But if I'll go in there, and if I perish, I perish. I don't like obstacles, but they make me pray. Right? I don't like uncertainty and difficulties, but they press me to God. Don't they do that for you? I can go astray until God's sheepdog comes after me. His sheepdog is named Trouble, and he often finds me. And then I know I've gone astray. I need to come on back with that sheepdog. Man, if Esther had the power to just reverse the whole situation, she certainly would have done that. But no, she's got to go in. She's got to face the music, and whatever happens is going to happen. Now, what do you suppose her flesh is screaming at this point? Don't do it. Stay out. You got it good. It's going to be okay for you. The king loves you, right? He's not going to do anything to you. Don't put yourself out there like that. But she had to say no to the flesh, right? And she had to say, okay, nope, I've got to do it. The Lord is telling me to do it. And if I perish, I perish. This is the pivotal point in the book, actually, right here. His people start praying. She asked them all to pray for her. And so they're all praying and fasting for 3 days. It's not about providence alone, but God works things out, that's for sure. But it's about bravery, but not just that. Although sometimes we have to face if I perish type of situations. It's about God's will working through human agency. And this is the part where the people get busy. They begin to pray. Their knees hit the floor, and they start fasting and praying for Queen Esther to be able to prevail for them. God's will working through human agency almost always starts with prayer. It's just where He goes first. When He gets our attention, the first thing that we're prompted to do is we start to pray. We acknowledge that we've heard Him and that He wants to use us and do something. Sennacherib was the king of Assyria. At one point, he sent a message to Hezekiah, the king of Judah. He says, don't think your God will save you any more than He saved all these other nations. I've rolled over all of them like a steamroller. You're going to be exactly the same and devoured. Hezekiah took the letter from Sennacherib, and he spread it out before the Lord, before the altar of the Lord, and cried out to Him. Isaiah sent word. He said, God says to the king of Assyria, you have blasphemed against me. You will return the way you came. And that night, the Lord slew 185 of Sennacherib's men. And he turned around and he went back home. Now, you might say, well, God would have done that anyway. But I'm not so sure, except that Hezekiah went in and spread that letter out before Him. He said, look what they're doing. Look what they're saying, Lord. You're our only help, our only hope. And the Lord acted. Well, Esther said, pray and fast for me. We pray all the time, hopefully. I do all the time. I know oftentimes I wonder if it's praying or whining, but God is gracious. He hears me anyway. When something gets serious, then we fast and we pray. That means we don't eat or we don't eat as much as we normally would eat. And don't get me wrong, it's not a hunger strike against God, okay? Don't think of it that way. Lord, I'm not going to eat until you do this. Don't try it. He's pretty patient. No, fasting is the opposite. Fasting is the humbling of our flesh so that we can concentrate on the thing that God has before us. That's what that's all about. So they did that. And after 3 days, Esther went in. And miraculously, the king accepted her. He extends his scepter to her, and she comes in, and he asks her, what do you want? You've come in, and what's your request? Chapter 5, Esther chapter 5, find verse 4. Esther said, if it pleases the king, may the king and Haman come this day to the banquet that I have prepared for him. Then the king said, bring Haman, boo, quickly, that we may go and do as Esther desires. So the king and Haman, boo, came to the banquet which Esther had prepared. As they drank their wine at the banquet, the king said to Esther, what is your petition? For it shall be granted to you. And what is your request? Even to half the kingdom it will be done. Oh, ladies, my goodness. What a credit card he just handed her. So Esther replied, my petition and my request is, if I found favor in the sight of the king, and if it pleases the king to grant my position and do what I request, may the king and Haman come to the banquet that I'll prepare for them, and tomorrow I will do as the king says. Wow. Man, all this buildup, and then she said, oh, come back tomorrow. We'll have another banquet tomorrow. You and Haman, boo, come, and tomorrow I'll tell you what I want. What? Why didn't she just ask right then? I mean, he just said, hey, anything, up to half the kingdom. It'll be yours. I don't know. Maybe she was afraid at that point. Maybe the conversation wasn't going that way. You know, I mean, could be that, you know, that Haman, boo, was, you know, bending his ear about the Jews again. So she said, decided, oh, I need another banquet. Let's do this tomorrow. I don't know. But you know what? Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you can't practice diplomacy and tact with people, okay? You do have the truth. You don't have to blurt it out like a 2x4 in the face. Right? We can be diplomatic. We can be tactful with people. We can take the long way around and first build a relationship with them. First show an interest in them and the things that they're interested in. There'll be plenty of time to lower the boom on them later, okay? So she's really being cagey here. Verse 9. Then Haman went out that day, glad and pleased of heart. But when Haman saw Mordecai in the king's gate and that he did not stand up or tremble before him, Haman was filled with anger against Mordecai. Haman controlled himself, however, and went to his house and sent for his friends and his wife Zeresh. Then Haman recounted to them all the glory of his riches. Notice how many times the word his comes up here. The glory of his riches, the number of his sons, every instance where the king had magnified him, and how he had promoted him above the princes and servants of the king. Oy vey! Man, enough already with about you, okay? Let somebody else into the conversation. But this is the flesh, right? The flesh is all about muy. It's all nine. It's all me. So Haman also said, boo, even Esther the queen, let no one but me come with the king to the banquet which she had prepared. And tomorrow I am invited by her with the king. Oh, he's so happy about this. Oh my goodness, how the flesh is so stuck on itself. Author Wayne Mack, this was written on a dust cover of a book. Author Wayne Mack is a graduate of Wheaton College with a Bachelor of Arts, the Philadelphia Seminary with an MDiv in Greek, the Westminster Theological Seminary with a Divinity of Ministry degree, and he has also been involved in extensive graduate studies in various subjects at various graduate schools, and they're listed. Wayne conducted seminars and conferences all over our country and around the world. He has also functioned as director of a counseling center and training school and done extensive counseling. The book title is Humility, a Forgotten Virtue. Oh, I just love irony. Oh, the flesh doesn't even recognize it, though. I mean, it can be making just a fool out of itself and, you know, just thinking, oh, I'm so proud of myself, you know. So Haman, boo, recounts all of his glory and his good points, how he's esteemed and he's honored. But just like the flesh, you know, don't deceive yourself. This is in you and me, right? Because this is that thing that God has says wars against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh. Verse 13. Yet, all of this does not satisfy me every time I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate. Just that one guy. Just him. And it's all spoiled for him. He's all out of sorts because of that one guy. So, his wife and all his friends say, hey, build a gallows 50 cubits high, and in the morning ask the king to have Mordecai hanged on it. I mean, he's already disobeying the king's command, right? Fantastic! What a great idea! You are great friends. So he calls up Jiffy Gallows. They get right on it. A 75-foot gallows is built right there in Haman's front yard for Mordecai. And these gallows, they don't use a rope, they use a spike. That's how you hang somebody in Persia. So, chapter 6. Dun, dun, dun. Things are not looking good for the Jews and not for Mordecai for sure. During that night, the king could not sleep. I love that. He's the king of the largest kingdom ever, and God doesn't let him sleep, just like me. So, he says, he gave an order to bring the book of records, the Chronicles, and they were read before the king. Some of you guys do that with our teaching tapes, I understand, and it really is hurtful to me, but whatever works for you, that's okay. So, by coincidence, he said with air quotes, they pull just this certain scroll and they open to just this certain place in that scroll that talks about Mordecai saving the king from the plot. The king, I like this. This is good. We need to encourage more of this. This man saved the king's life. That's fantastic. What did we do for him? Nothing. Oh, what? I need somebody to figure this out. We've got to do something for this man. This kind of behavior needs to be rewarded. Well, just then, again by coincidence, Haman had come into the court to ask for Mordecai's execution. Oh my goodness, it couldn't work out any better. Look, there's Haman. Bring him in here. Bring him in here. He'll tell me how to do it. So he says, Haman, what should be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor? Well, Haman, boo, who could that be except me? Let's see, what do I want? Put the king's robe on him and the king's crown on his head, and put him on a horse that only the king has ridden, and lead him through the streets, saying, 'Thus it shall be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor.'" And the king said, "Great idea. Go do all that for Mordecai the Jew." Oh, my goodness. Worst day ever. He has to do it. He does the whole thing, puts the robe on him, puts the crown. He's going through the streets, and he has to say the words. And there's Mordecai sitting there. Oh, my goodness. Worst day ever for the flesh. Verse 12. "Then Mordecai returned to the king's gate, but Haman hurried home, mourning with his head covered." Oh, he tells his wife and his friends all about his terrible day. And now they say, "This is not going to end well for you, for we see that things are turning against you." Verse 14, "While they were still talking with him, the king's eunuchs arrived and hastily brought Haman to the banquet which Esther had prepared. So Haman, he tries to make the best of things. He's here, okay, well, yeah, at least I've got this banquet that the queen wanted to throw for me and the king. So no doubt he's on his best behavior there during the dinner that evening. Chapter 7, verse 3. "Then Queen Esther replied, 'If I found it," this is the big thing now. She's fed them again. The king doesn't know what she wants, and it's the second day. "And if I found favor in your sight, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given to me as my petition and my people as my request. For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed and annihilated." Verse 5. "Then King Ahasuerus asked Queen Esther, 'Who is he, and where is he who would presume to do thus?' Esther said, 'A foe and an enemy is this wicked Haman.'" "Then he became terrified before the king and queen." Well, the king is outraged. He's beside himself. He walks out into the garden to try and compose himself and think about this. Haman, stays with Esther to plead for his life. Just as the king returns, Haman falls on Esther. Now, Jewish tradition says an angel pushed him. I don't know, but I wouldn't put it past Gabriel, you know? That guy's got a streak. So just as the king is coming back and he falls on her as he's pleading with her for his life, and the king is, "What? Will you also attack the queen right in front of me?" Then Harbonah, one of the eunuchs who were before the king, said, "Behold, indeed, the gallows standing at Haman's house." 50 cubits high, which Haman, made for Mordecai, who spoke good on behalf of the king. And then it all comes together. This is the guy I just honored yesterday, and he had a gallows made for him. And he said, "Hang him on it." So they hang Haman, on the gallows which he had prepared for Mordecai, and the king's anger subsided. In chapter 8, the king lets Esther and Mordecai write another edict, because the edicts of the Persians and the Medes can't be rescinded. They're forever. So they write another one that says, yes, on that day they can be attacked, but they can defend themselves. They can fight back and attack their enemies on that day, the 13th day of the 12th month. And so they did. They killed thousands of their enemies. Throughout the whole 127 provinces, the Jews rose up and avenged themselves against their enemies on that day. Now, in most areas, it was a mixed population. So life kind of went on, you know, there was a few people disappeared and, you know, something happened to their stuff, but that life just went on. But there was one place that you might expect to only find enemies of the Jews, and that was Samaria. And of all things, archaeologists have found and identified a burn layer and years of disuse dated to this time. But it's not explained by any incursions. There wasn't any enemy force that came in at that time to destroy them. It was this. It was the Jews that were avenging themselves on their enemies at that time. So, chapter 8, verse 15, end of the story, the epilogue, as the music is playing and the credits start to roll. Then Mordecai went out from the presence of the king in royal robes of blue and white, in a large crown of gold, in a garment of fine linen and purple, and the city of Susa shouted and rejoiced. That's what happens when you get the wrong man out and the right man in. Then there's shouting and rejoicing that happens. Confusion is replaced with celebration. So the personal agenda of the flesh is cast down, and God's plans and purposes are advanced. Last week, we noted another verse together, and that is, God causes all things to work together for what? Good to those who love God. Now, isn't this a wonderful example of that? The word causes all things to work together. That's a pharmaceutical term. It means to intermingle. He causes all things to work. He mixes them together, all the things, the good things and the bad things. God knows just how to bring them together and mix them together to make good come out for those who love him. And that's what the Jews celebrate in the story of Esther. Let's pray. Lord, again, we come before you, thanking you for your goodness towards us. Maybe we're a little ashamed tonight that we've doubted you. We've maybe judged you at a low point in our life, Lord. We know that these times come, but Lord, we also know that you control all these things and that you love us and that you'll never leave us. And Lord, you've got a plan for us in Christ, and it will be carried out. Lord, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we will be rejoicing on that day. Lord, praise you for all of this. Thank you, Lord, for all your goodness towards us, Lord. And help us, Lord, with the hard times to see your hand working for us behind the scenes. Lord, we bless you tonight, and we give you again our hearts and our lives. Bless the church and your people in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks for joining us online to watch one of our messages. I hope it was encouragement to you. Before you click off the tab and continue with your day, I want to invite you to partner with us with your financial blessing and offering and gifts to the Lord. You can find our giving button right above us on the upper right-hand side of the screen. We hope that we're able to continue to bless you in the future. God bless.